Magnetic resonance imaging, or MRI for short, can be modeled in the following way. Let's first consider this conducting loop of wire. The magnetic dipole moment is defined as the current going through the wire times the cross-sectional area that that wire encloses times a unit vector that is perpendicular to the surface area. So that the magnetic dipole moment points in the direction that is perpendicular to the surface area, like so. So we define this. A proton is believed to spin on its axis at the subatomic level. And so because it's spinning, we have all this charge on the proton. The charge has a certain, it has an amount. It's 1.602 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs. So we have all this charge spinning around. So we effectively have a bunch of little current loops stacked right on top of one another. And these current loops all add up to give a magnetic dipole moment. So this magnetic dipole moment is the sum of a bunch of little current loops. Okay, so whenever you take a dipole moment and you put it in an external magnetic field, it will experience a torque. And that torque is given by the following equation. Mu cross B. And what this says is that basically this dipole moment here, the magnetic dipole moment, will tend to line up with the magnetic field. So look, here's the B field, here's the magnetic dipole moment. We cross this into here, and we get a torque out of the board, which means this thing is going to rotate this way. It rotates in the direction of your fingers, and so this thing will be torqued this way, right? So the magnetic dipole moment will have a tendency to line up with an external B field, but it won't line up all the way. It will line up, the angular momentum of the spinning top, so to speak, will prevent it from lining up completely, but that it will have a precession axis like so. So we can consider this thing like a top. It's rotating on its axis, but then also precessing about a precession axis, where the precession axis is in the direction of the external magnetic field, okay? Much like a top. Now we're going to take some radiation and emit that radiation laterally towards the precession axis. I have not drawn, this is an electromagnetic wave, but I have not drawn the electric field component just for the sake of a clean picture that's useful for description. And so we see this thing is oscillating in and out of the board like so, and traversing laterally towards the precession axis. And if the angular frequency of this is equal to the angular frequency of this, we will have resonance. So we can define omega L, the Lamar angular frequency, to be equal to gamma times the external B field that's applied, B zero. And so this value here is 2.67 times 10 to the eighth, okay? And then, so if we substitute 2 pi f, this converts radians per second to oscillations per second. So we have 2 pi f, and this is f sub l is equal to gamma b zero. And then dividing by 2 pi, we get f sub l is equal to gamma over 2 pi b zero. And then this is equal to 42 megahertz, that is times 10 to the 6th, per unit Tesla, like this, times the external B field that is applied. Okay? So if the frequency of this thing is matching the frequency of this guy, then whenever he comes around, say when he's like right here, this guy is coming in, and so he's coming into contact with this B field vector that is out of the board. And so as a result of the cross product, they want to line up with one another. He experiences a torque that tends to line him up, and so he flattens out this way. But then as he continues to process around, this guy back here is coming, and when he gets back here, now he's lining up with this guy back here because this thing is traversing past the proton, and so he flattens out some more back there. And then when he comes around the front, he's flattening out more here. And so constantly his precession is flattening out like this. And then when the radiation is turned off, he flips back to where he was initially. That is, precessing around around an axis that is parallel to the external magnetic field. Okay? This is the fundamental mover in the magnetic resonance imaging machine. And this description here, this is magnetic resonance. Okay? It was previously called nuclear resonance, but for political reasons, I presume, the name was changed to magnetic resonance to not, you know, freak people out on the table, so to speak. I think people will get a little bit more, you know, weary of stepping into a nuclear machine, you know? So let's take a look at a group of hydrogen atoms. So the body has a lot of hydrogen in it. We have a lot of water, and as a result, H2O, we have a lot of hydrogen. And so initially, all these hydrogen atoms have dipole moments that are oriented in all these different directions, just totally random. But then we apply an external magnetic field like so. And all the atoms, all the protons line up like so. Okay, and so they're rotating, but they're also precessing about an axis that is parallel to that magnetic field. But then we emit radiation that is lateral to that precession axis. That radiation comes in and flattens them out as discussed previously. So it's rotating, it's precessing around like this and rotating, but then it's flattening out. And then when that radiation is turned off, all of the atoms, all of these hydrogen atoms, flip back into this case here, to this direction. And then going from here to here, whenever they flip back, you can think of it as a spring. You know, they're being pulled back. It's like, you know, cocking a spring. And then when the radiation is turned off, they all flip back to where they want to be, back to here. And radiation is emitted. And that radiation can be detected and accounted for and to form an image. And so in 1973, there was a breakthrough by a man by the name of P.C. Lauterbur was his name. And he said, okay, what if we take a human and we stick him in this tube here? And he didn't do it with a human. He did it with some other stuff, obviously. But the idea extends to humans and obviously has. But if we stick a human in this tube and we take this superconducting magnet that has a very strong magnetic field in the neighborhood of 5 Tesla. And so we have a magnetic field along the axis of this tube. Then all of the protons will line up like this. They'll be doing this number, right? Okay. And then he said, okay, but what if we apply a secondary magnetic field that will produce a field gradient so that the magnetic field is increasing along the axis of the tube? Okay. And then we can, so we have a changing magnetic field along the axis of the tube, so that the Lamar frequency has different values along this tube here. Okay, so the Lamar frequency, so you come out to say 1.3 meters, you come up and you find the B value. You know, this is some B value, we'll call it B, you know, B1. And this would be, let's see, B0, B0, yeah, we're good, okay. We call this B1, all right, and some value greater than B0. And then you come here and you plug in B1 here and you find some new Lamar frequency. Well, then you take radiation and emit it into the cavity, and only protons that are precessing at that frequency will emit radiation. So if you look, if I've drawn this right above this on purpose, so if you translate down here, only hydrogen atoms that are in this slice here will emit radiation. You turn the radiation on, you flatten out their precession axes, you know, their precession axes are flattening out, then you turn the radiation off and they spring back. Whenever they're springing back, they're emitting radiation. But the flattening out of those precession axes only occurs in this little region. It doesn't occur in any of these other regions because of the field gradient is increasing like this, so these all have different Lamar frequencies, right? And so they resonate at different frequencies, and so will only resonate at this specific frequency associated with 1.3 meters. Okay? And that's it. That's the basic idea. Now, this this thing has gotten complicated. There's all these unique. This is, you see the saddle coil here. This is the secondary coil used to create this magnetic field gradient. But electrical engineers have come up with a variety of different geometries for coils, so they can not only modify or have an electric field gradient in the Z direction. But they can also have, and I think I said Z, or if I said X, pardon my gaffe if I said X. But they can not only have a magnetic field gradient in the Z direction, but they can also have one in the X direction and the Y direction. And so you'll have just little bitty cubes of matter in the person emitting radiation. Now, only parts of the body that have water in it will emit radiation. And so places where there's a lot of water and tissue and so forth will emit a lot, and you'll get a white picture right there. But places like bone, where there's not a lot of water, won't emit a lot of radiation, and so you won't have much of an image exposure right there in the data that's collected. And so this is the general idea. Okay, see you next time.